I would just say, let's begin talking about your story, where you're coming from, and what you're doing here.
Yeah, well, I obviously come from Italy. You can tell from the accent and the name. I studied in Milan, computer science, and then I went on and did a PhD also in software engineering. And as part of my postdoc, I moved to UC Berkeley. I actually, during my PhD, I was in the UMD, University of Maryland in College Park, where I did some research there. And then I came here at UC Berkeley. And at UC Berkeley, I met another Paola, also from Italy, also in the computer science or in software. We became friends, and after the postdoc, we both started our careers in the industry, parallel paths, different things. Fast forward 15 years, we are still good friends. We've traveled a lot, we climbed mountains, went scuba diving, so we did a lot of things together. She moved to Portland and worked to work for Intel. And visited here in a cafe in Noi Valley. Oh. And so we were just talking about work and life, and she brought up this problem that she had at work. She was working at that time, the cloud was already picking up, but it wasn't as popular as it is today. But she said that they had customers at Intel, like Facebook and Google, where they were going, giving these huge deliveries, of their hardware and software. And after one of those, they got a call from Facebook saying, well, it doesn't work. We tested it on our test bed, which is 16,000 servers. That was the test environment. Yeah, and we have a problem. And when they were testing in their 5 servers, at Intel, they didn't have the problem. So they looked, to get 16,000 servers, but they managed to get maybe to a couple of hundred. So she started to think, but there must be, since we are in the cloud, there must be a way of leveraging the cloud to test the cloud. Mm-hmm. And that's how, the thought started. And we started to look at ways of using the cloud as an environment to, help other people. We looked for products. Some were there, but they were kind of old. And in the new things, there were just a couple of things, but not much going on. So we thought it was a good opportunity. And that's how the two Paola started.
Okay. And you started
Nuvola. And we started Nuvola, yes. Oh, yeah. And
this is so when did you move here?
I moved here in 94, end of 94, 95.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, so it's been a while, yeah.
Pretty much the same time.
Yeah,
you
moved.
Yeah. Yeah. All right, so and you decided to start it from scratch, a new company, two women in tech.
Yes.
What was the challenge there?
Two women in tech.
Okay.
You said it, yeah. Well, actually, at the very beginning, everything was a challenge, from starting the, you start from zero, we don't even have a website, you don't have a prototype, you don't have anything, yeah? So you have to, and you probably have done similar things, so mm-hmm. I mean, we both had in our career, some experience with startups, but we were part of an existing startup, so we never started one from mm-hmm. scratch. So, yeah, the biggest challenge was to be, first of all, to have a plan for a plan. So so we followed the lean startup approach. I don't know if you mm-hmm. heard about it. So it's a methodology that has been developed in the last 15 years, and it works similar to the agile development. So you go via iterations, and you build your company in steps, iteratively growing. So we did that, but still there were a lot of of unknowns, and even the lean startup requires a lot of pieces. It's like a puzzle, so that you have to put together. So that was challenging. And then, that was definitely the very first challenge, just to get kind of the pieces together. But then, yeah, another challenge was the being two women in tech. Yeah.
So what, how does that translate? What was the challenge? The credibility or?
Yes.
What?
Yeah, some of it could be that, you know, being also now in the Silicon Valley, you know, I realized that you really, that almost nobody starts from scratch in the sense that you have to be connected. And we didn't have that type of connection. I mean, we obviously were connected with the other, you know, developers. You know, we both came from a technical background, but just to create the credibility, you know, in front of investors, in front of people, it took a long time. And as we were told also directly, we didn't fit the pattern, you know.
Exactly.
You know, the pattern is two young white male.
Right.
And we were, the only thing we had was white. Yes. You know, the rest wasn't there. Yeah, which was, you know, it was something, I guess, but it wasn't enough.
Right. So how did you manage to overcome this problem? How did you get your first yes, we're going to give you $1 million?
Yeah, well, we never got really that big yes. But the financing, yeah, came through angel investors mainly. Mm. So, and some friends and family. But even with angel investor wasn't individual angels. We took part to several conferences, and we won three of them, one after the other. And so we managed to, get the big check in a way of these groups. So that was what kind of got us started.
Okay.
But to get there, it was hard. Yeah.
Oh, I can imagine. Did you get customers before?
Yeah. Well, we got customers around the time we won. I think the week before we won the first of the conferences. So initially, what we did it was following the approach of the Lean Startup. You know, we started with the interviews. You know, one of the things that they tell you is like, if you have an idea, you want to talk to people who might benefit from that idea and see if there is, you know, a response. And so we started with the idea. So we really had a PowerPoint initially. Then we started with a prototype. So, and we got some feedback, you know, and so we started to build also from that. And so the first customers were people who kind of saw us growing and build what they wanted in a way. So, and that's how they became our first customers, yeah.
Okay. And how is it now? Now that you started the company and you have a business and customers, how's the factor of being two women in tech is playing now? Is it still a factor?
It is always a factor. Yes, it is always a factor. You know, I went to a conference here. We had a booth, and I was talking to people around, and then someone came, and we had someone in marketing. It was a man. And they went to the men and said, yeah, the girl that is going around is really cool. You know, she knows things. I said, well, that's the CTO of the company. But that's how, you know, people perceive you. You know, it's really hard to get beyond that perception. And, you know, there's a bias, I think, that always stays there, you know, in a way. So.
And then we're going to talk a little bit more specific of what your company does, but can you also tell us your first customer, your first big deal that you had? When did it happen? And
yeah, that happened. So after when we started, we had some customers, but we still were like in the MVP stage, you know, the minimum viable product phase. So it was really kind of limited functionality and so on. But early on, still, we were growing in that area. A few months later, we got Nike that was interested in us. You know, and Nike is in Portland. So our first customers were definitely coming from kind of word of mouth. But even like, you know, parents talking in the playground, you know, things like this. You know, it's that's how sometimes things happen.
Right.
Yeah. And so. So we started to talk to this person, and they were using, they had other solutions, but they realized that what they were using, it took them 3 days to do something that it took him 10 minutes to do with our product. So obviously, yeah. So performance is not just the performance of your, the application, but it's right. Also how fast you can deliver.
The ease of use.
All right.
Well, tell us about Nuvola. What problem do you solve?
Yeah, so Nuvola is a performance testing solution for web and mobile applications and APIs. So we solve the problem that probably a lot of you have, you know, experienced directly, or we try to help solve that problem. That when you go to, let's say, it's Cyber Monday or it's Black Friday, or maybe if you remember Obamacare when it started, or you know, it's tax day and everybody is trying to fill in. So this is one of the typical problems we try to solve. So we, if they had used our product, they wouldn't have had the problems, you know. And so often applications crash because they are not, ready for the load that they are receiving. So what we do, we provide a solution that helps you test the application, generate the traffic before you go live or before an event happens, so that you can see if your application is really able to manage the crowd. Because if you are Netflix, you cannot ask your 20 million users, go there that day just to test my app. So you need to be able to get that thing before that happens. And so we have a software that generates what we call the virtual users, but the users are virtual, so they're software-based, but they generate real traffic. Mm. So they go to the application as if it was, a real traffic, a real user, and then we collect metrics so they can tell you how well the application is doing, or if there is errors or crashes, then you will see if that happens. So it's not just to test the limits of the application, but also to test really the everyday user experience in a way.
Okay. So how do you manage to generate so much traffic? What resources do you have that allow you to generate?
We have the cloud, Like I said earlier, we use the cloud to test the cloud. We are based now on Amazon AWS. We've been there actually almost since the beginning, and we use. We have algorithms, we developed a solution that can instantiate as many servers as we need on demand, so they can then generate the traffic, and then once they're done, we pull them down. So we manage them all over the world. Now we are in 15 different geographic locations, mm-hmm. from Asia, Europe, and the Americas, and we're going to follow Amazon as it expands. And we're looking also at other locations where Amazon is not reaching, but there is a need still for.
So you will use another service.
Other service provider. Yeah.
Okay, and who's the company uses your product, but within the company, who's the user of your technology?
Yeah, good question. So what we have kind of two personas that sometimes become now one, but so in general we have either QA people or developers. So in fact, at Nike, actually, they were developers who used us first. Mm. Because also in many organizations, the role of the developers and the role of the QA are merging. They are the concept of DevOps, that it's one of the buzzwords in the last few years. It's really the ability of merging these two roles in a way in one. If you talk to Facebook, they tell you, we don't have a QA team. Which doesn't mean that they don't do QA. It means that everybody does QA, okay? And the story is not like, there's no more QA. It's just that QA is everywhere. So if more traditional companies have still a QA organization, often we fall there. But if there is more of a blended organization, then we could have developers using us.
And you guys do also automatic testing, so that
you can do automation. Yes,
okay.
We have APIs as well that you can use to generate, and we do also integration. Yeah.
And did you test your API with your?
Yes, yes. We do test our. Yeah.
So, going back a little bit to the starting the company, it I think it's one of the most difficult things you can do. It's starting your own company. It's really hard. And so what was the thing that you now think, oh, we did it right, and that was determinant? And what was the mistake that now you have a little regret about?
Well, what I think we did right is when we started to work on this lean startup, and we were really in a phase like, okay, how do we go from here, you know, to really have something? We looked for accelerator programs. And for us, being in an accelerator, we ended up in a small accelerator in Bend, Oregon, founded by two experienced entrepreneurs. They were coming from the Silicon Valley and moved there and wanted to help also companies locally or actually there were other companies coming from the Bay Area there too. It was a small group, it's called Founders Path, and they followed, so they gave us a lot of support. It was a very intimate environment in a way, and really made us accelerate. We realized that we were there for 3 months, and we went from having some ideas to kind of have a company. It helped us to understand our roles, understand what we wanted, come up with a message, a brand, everything. So it was really a big push for us. So
it gave you some mentorship.
Yes, very strong, and they still important. Do today. So they're really important for that. And
the
then
mistake?
And the mistake was that following all this lean startup, one of the, for me, myths that comes out is that if you do it right, the product will sell by itself. You know, you don't need, you know, to do anything. You know, and for me, that's I wouldn't say it's a lie, but it's true when you think about if you think in terms of the traditional sales, you know, business and protocols, but it really still requires a lot of things. I've heard even here at Geeks, Italian Geeks meetups, people saying, oh, our product sold by itself. And then they start talking, we had this army of marketing people. And then whenever someone would come in, you know, would sign up, we would have someone calling right away and said, well, how do you call that? Yeah, you know, you don't have the salespeople in the sense, the typical sales guy that they take the plane and from Monday to Friday knock at doors and companies.
Right.
Yeah, you don't do that anymore. But you still have to have someone that can sell. And we definitely underestimated that part. And that,
So you were like, oh, we built this amazing thing. Where are the customers?
Yes,
where
are the customers? Exactly. You know, it might work well if you have maybe a B2C kind of business, you know, where you have, you know, people that are friends and family in the spread, or if you have collaboration tools because one pulls the other, that might be true. But for a B2B that is very specific to developers and you don't really need others to use it, you know, you can just use it yourself, it's really hard to spread it. And people don't, if they don't hear about you, then they can't come to you. So our first customer were all people that we, you know, we're in another, we met, you know.
Yeah.
Either in a conference or an event, so mostly word of mouth. But if you don't have a good marketing machine, maybe more than sales, it's true, you don't need maybe a lot of sales, but then you need a sales following up and keeping up with you, it's really hard.
And you mentioned it, so you simulate a lot of customer, a lot of people hitting the website, right? And that's one of the problem, you know, when you have a peak in traffic. But another problem is security. And denial of service attack is also a lot of traffic. Do you also provide, what do you do in that sector?
Well, we've talked about this. So far, we haven't seen, although this was one of the original idea, you know, when you talk about pivoting and things, you know, there was one of the, you know, few things they said, oh, that could be a good path. So far, we haven't seen at least our approach really being used in the way of security. You know, in theory, it could be. You know, you could generate, you know, DDoS with our system, but we haven't seen really are used in that area. I'm not saying that it's not possible. We talked to some people, they thought it was a good idea. But again, it's about resources and time, and you know how you know you choose your market. So for now, it hasn't been.
But in a way, I guess with your system, your customer test their API to the breaking
yes.
point, so that
they
have
could.
The limit.
Yeah.
Okay. Or to what they think is going to be their peak traffic.
Or what they think is their. It's not. You know, we saw kind of three main patterns on how people use the solution. One is to find the critical point where you break, but that is maybe like a minor part. The other two things that we saw that have been used. One is kind of for capacity planning. There is this idea that you know, if your system is low, you just add a few more servers and then it will speed up. But that's not really true, and you end up, you know, reaching a point that you know you're gonna spend more money in more, you know, in resources, and this is not gonna give you any improvement. So, and you actually try to save the money. So you want to find a balance where you can tweak your system in a way that will perform better without having to add more cost, or actually might be able to reduce costs. So that is one area. And then the other is really just the user experience, making sure that you have your target, your load, and how will the system respond with that load,
right.
even if it's not a breaking point.
Yeah, response time.
And there's,
sure
exactly, making sure that things work sometimes. Also making sure things work from different geographies, you know, maybe your system is here, or you have a CDN, do this, you know, there's a lot of things that you can think of. You
and
know.
Do you have also like a monitoring system where you constantly hit the API service, making sure that they are still performing at optimal level, like an ongoing service?
Yeah, well, we can use our solution in a kind of as a what we call a synthetic monitoring, so just having this repeating hitting the target a little bit like a ping. Then we also integrate with other monitoring solutions too that can also give us some information as well. So
if the system goes down, then you make a phone call to the DevOps,
yeah.
right? In the middle of the night.
Yes.
Yeah. So, and the other thing is, you know, people write tests for their software, for their API, but there is always a difference between, you know, the automatic test and then the real user that has an unpredictable pattern of actions,
yeah.
right? So how do you manage to really simulate the user as realistically as possible?
Yeah. So there are two things. First of all, you know, there's also this what is called RAM. You know, there's a real user monitoring and there is synthetic testing. So these two things, some people try to put them one against each other. But I actually wrote a blog and I said, you know, it's like, you know. They are more like cookie and milk, you know, you need both, you know, to have a good combination. So I think having a real user still and monitoring the real user behavior is important. So it's not,
okay.
so our okay. solution is not trying to say, once you test it with us, then you can just turn your monitoring off and go and take a vacation. No. You still need to monitor because you know there are some situations that are unpredictable and they can change for many different ways. It's a little bit like any type of testing. You try to cover as much as you can, but it's hard to get 100% coverage. We definitely have our solution as well as others. I mean, there's also. In the field of synthetic monitoring, synthetic testing, you try to reproduce as close as possible. So you can get very sophisticated by recreating different patterns, modifying some of the variables, so creating some randomization, combination of things. So you try to make it as close as possible to the real world. And that's what we often say, it's like a real world scenarios.
Right.
Yeah.
So I have one more question, but you have some slides that maybe you want to go through, or did we cover it?
We probably covered it. I mean, I can talk a little bit more about the API's performance in particular, and okay. Yeah, if we have, do we have time? See, I think
yes.
we, yeah. Yes. Yeah, so when we talk about API, and you know, one of the things that I mentioned is that APIs and DevOps as well. You know, so we mentioned the fact that there are like one of the changes that are happening these days is really the combination of having like engineering different. That's how I define it, is DevOps. There are many ways. It's a big buzzword right now. But the way I see DevOps is really like a synergy of different organizations within a company mm-hmm. to achieve a common goal of faster development life cycle and deployment life cycle. Right. So, and the way you work it is like you, in a way, it's like applying the concept of agile, not just to the development, but to the whole organization. So one of the key components for me for DevOps is automation and iteration. So, and that's the way I see. I mean, there are obviously other aspects that we can, of the DevOps in general, but definitely these two are important. We touched this point briefly, we're talking about iteration, but I think it's really what makes a difference. And so these are some of the advantages of DevOps that I don't want to go much into details. But I think the important part is really that that DevOps it's about being automation and being like being to cover the complete development life cycle. So and within the context, when we're talking about continuous delivery, continuous integration, it really implies also what we call continuous testing. And actually, it was early this week, there was a conference here in San Francisco about continuous testing. It's becoming like the newest buzzwords, but it definitely, it is part of this this configuration. And if you look at how then, where the API testing, API performance, and application performance, where it fits, it's really in the whole pipeline, and this is an example of how, a typical DevOps pipeline could work. You know, it's always part of iteration, so where you move step by step until you find a roadblock and then go back or you move forward. And the way, the performance testing, the location that typically we see is the acceptor test. But actually for API testing in particular, often APIs happen even earlier in the process. And because you can start looking at APIs as individual, elements, and then also as part of a more complex, scenario. I have a customer who's, I have a customer who's building a new application of microservices, and containers. Mm-hmm. So, and these are like the new things, now. And and APIs are key, and that's why APIs are becoming really, we are seeing really an explosion in a way of the use of APIs. There's just conferences about API, like API World. And and performance in this area is becoming crucial because at the end it's like what's underlying your application is a set of APIs, already with the agile and cloud and modular, but with the microservices and container even more so. So it's important to test even earlier. So what he's often doing is starting testing the individual microservice and APIs, and then puts them a few together, and then expands, iterates and does the testing. So, and looking again at the continuous testing and continuous delivery, they go hand in hand. You see, testing is part of every step in different ways, but you can apply, the concept maybe more in the performance, but also at the level of production or pre-production, but even earlier on, or even later, like in the monitoring after you produce. You still, like we told earlier, we do the real user monitoring and pinging and things like that. So we talked about the APIs and the advantages, why it's a very, they're becoming very powerful because they're very modular. They can be, changed. You can change in isolation, and it makes interaction with all the other servers clearer. At the same time, it creates these spider webs of, of systems that it's really hard to manage and to control. Yeah. Yes.
Not very well.
And Yeah, I don't know if I have. Yeah, I think that's kind of all I had. Yeah.
That's great. Thank you. So, you know, we talk about all these things, DevOps, continuous integration, and all these buzzwords, right? And you just mentioned before we started this conversation that you were just a few years ago in Italy and nobody knew about any of it. Not because these are things are new. They don't feel new to us, maybe because we are in the middle of it every day, but they're very new. And they change constantly, right? And in the future, in a year from now, we don't know what is going to be, right?
Yeah.
So how do you keep up? And what do you see your company be in the future?
In the future.
So there's two questions in one. So how do you keep up with the fast evolution of this environment?
Yeah.
And what do you see in the future happening for your company?
Yeah, well, keep up is a lot of reading and going to conferences, looking, you know, at the materials, but also talking to customers, you know, like as often are the customers that they can tell you kind of the trends. You know, if you start talking to, you know, someone that says, hey, I want to use it this way, or like, yeah, the concept of microservices and API and containers, it came, you know, you can see that these are coming up because more and more people are going to talk about these things and say, yeah, I want to apply your my performance testing to containers or to microservices and or APIs. Like we saw, for instance, we have the ability of importing one of the tools that are now popular for the API developers is Postman.
I use it.
You know about it. Yeah, it's becoming a little bit like the standard de facto, you know, for you know, for testing. And we do have a way of integrating with Postman, so we can you create your API testing in Postman, and then you can import them into
nice.
Our solution. And that's actually what this developer did. You know, he was doing the, you know, testing on the microservice from Postman, and then just when he was happy with the testing per se, the functional part, then he pulled it in into our load testing. And so he just, you know, did an import and started to run tests on you know, performance. So it makes it really easy, and we saw that that has been having a good traction, you know, for people.
So you react quickly, you see a signal like that, and you like,
and
okay.
You know where you have to go, yeah. And what we see as a trend in general is about kind of the integrations with other solutions, and at the same time, the ability of kind of plug and play the way you like it, you know. So people don't like much a monolithic solution, like where they find everything in one place, but they want to take the best of everything, or the best for them, you know, because there isn't really the best, you know, like there isn't like the best language, there isn't the best stack or the best cloud. The best is what
best
suits
you
best, what's best for you. But the ability of being able of integrating all these pieces easily, I think it's key. So we do have APIs that we provide for automation, for instance, but also we have plugins that help you, like you know, like the ability of importing from Postman, or we have plugins to integrate with tools like Jenkins and Code Pipeline, TeamCD, so that they already, so you can just automatically run the test once you create your steps. So you don't have to look at our APIs. You just click import this plugin, and then you just you know, have your test and run it. So integrations, I think, moving forward is going to be even more so. So it's going to be one of the, I think, of the trends. You know, being able to, you know, talk easily with different parts. You know, we see that with monitoring too. You know, we have integration, for instance, with New Relic, but we are often asked of integration with other monitoring solutions. So it can be in different parts. People want to be able to pick and choose, but have kind of a seamless or as seamless as possible way of doing so. So that's one trend. And then the other trend that we see, it's in the data manipulation and machine learning, you know, AI.
Oh, okay.
So a lot of people also are telling us, okay, I can see, I don't know, my test, I run the test and my system crashes. And now what do I do? I mean, how do I find out why it crashed, you know, or where? What are my bottlenecks? Where is the, you know, I can see, yeah, more or less, but can you get me more information? So, and that's where we are also, we have a prototype, actually, more than a prototype, that applies, you know, some machine learning and to elaborate on some of the data we have and some other external data to provide correlation that can tell you, like, okay, yeah, you have a performance issues and probably this method is the one that is giving you problems, you know, in your application, or the database query might be slowing you down or something like that. So,
so in a few years, you think you're going to have a system that just call the DevOps or the developers.
Yeah.
Oh, you,
not
you
only
know,
have a problem.
Mistake.
Yes. Not only have a problem, but I can tell you where,
where
it is.
Where
yes.
it is. Oh, that's fantastic.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. Do we have questions from the audience? There we go. One.
I think you mentioned it, but I'm not sure if this was the right reason. So you said you use Amazon Web Services, right?
Yes.
And you do have servers and things in Europe. How is the new European privacy law going to affect you?
Yeah, well, Amazon deals mostly with a lot of these things, you know, like they have already, I mean, usually for what concerns the security, they have always, you know, different levels of security that you, and compliances. So they are already compliant with the GDPR, and so we're just, you know, basically relying on them, yeah. Yeah, that's one of the advantages that we found with using something like Amazon is that, you know, they have a service almost for everything you need and beyond because, but it's, yeah, they definitely take care of a lot of things for you.
Just a curiosity, you mentioned you have these virtual actors, right?
Yeah.
Users. What was the biggest set of virtual user you used to test something, if you know?
Yeah. So we have, there's the number of users and there's the number of users per second in a way. So we have, so when we define our set, you know, the parameter, when you define a test, you know, you set some parameters and what we define there is the number of users per second. Or the request that can be generated at least, you know, within a second. And 20,000 is what we got, but that generated millions of requests. Now, I don't have the exact number, but there were, like, you know, generates, you know, like about, I think...
those 20,000 users
per second.
Virtual user per second. So
yes.
That generates millions of requests per minute. We also have some blogs and we talked about, for instance, how when you create a test, you know, what are the, you know, the criteria that you have to, how do you, because one of the things like what do you test and how do you test it, you know, so there's other parts, you know, to, so it's not just saying, okay, I do a little test, but about what, you know, so you need to know what's your load realistically, because we got people saying, oh yeah, I have thousands of users, you know, but they were per month or something, you know, or so then you have to, you have to make sure, you know, we got some customers saying, oh yeah, can you manage 1,000, you know, then it turned out we could crash their system with 3. So yeah, 3 users were generating already, you know, hundreds of requests, and you know, you could crash it with 3 users. So yeah, Nike, we use 5-10,000 they use, and they are pretty heavy users. Yeah.
Congratulations for what you've done. I wish I discovered you a few years ago instead of doing everything this from
scratch
to test our own product. So,
yeah,
I wish I saved all those. One question, you mentioned that one of your latest developments is to pinpoint the method or the query that is actually slowing down the system. You mean that when you are done with this, I can avoid using things like AppDynamics?
Well, actually, no, we do use things like AppDynamics. Right now we have an integration with New Relic, and AppDynamics is one very high on top of our list. And like I said, we are still kind of in a beta prototype phase, so we are still tweaking the system. But we do have the integration is actually relying on data, and right now it's only AppDynamics. But our idea, New Relics. But our idea is to have data coming from other tools as well. So being able to integrate with different data coming from different parts, it could be CloudWatch, or other system information, and then create some correlations with this. So right now we do rely on our data and New Relic data to get a correlation. And and it's actually a good synergy that we're working on also with AppDynamics right now.
And given that we are an Italian geek, are you working with SysDig?
Well, we actually know Loris. Yeah, we talked about our ideas, and we started around the same time, and we definitely see some overlap, but we haven't really got to the point to integrate with them. Yeah, but it's definitely yes. I didn't know you knew them because I thought AppDynamics, everybody knows them, but yeah, SysDig is definitely one of the areas that we also looking into.
It's very interesting. So from what I understand, you are simulating a stress test, right? And actually I have a bunch of questions. So that is part of CI Jenkins? Is that how it is commonly used?
Well, you can use it part of CI Jenkins. We do have a plugin for Jenkins, but we have people using just by itself, either manually, or we have APIs. You can write your own scripts. We have integrations with other tools like Code Pipeline and TeamCD. So we are looking at other solutions too. So in the CI area as well. So you don't have to use it with Jenkins, but definitely talking about DevOps and automation, that's the trend that we see. Yeah.
Okay. That said, what type of databases is it commonly used? Like read-only or read-write OLTP, or does it matter? Does it not matter?
For us?
Yeah.
So our database or our database or
no, not yours.
The customers.
Where is it being used? What type of applications is it being used? Read-only or typical NoSQL?
Well, that I don't know, because we're coming from the outside, okay? That's what we always say. We are infrastructure agnostics and system agnostics. We are on AWS, but the applications can be anywhere, and they can use a database, they can use two databases, they can use whatever they want. If they go to the APIs level, they might test a database, but we really have no, we don't collect this type of data, what they're using it, how they're using it, unless they told to us, but that never came up.
So are you using Jmeter in order to?
No, we are, right now we are independent from Jmeter. So there has been, the reason we consider initially, the Jmeter, and what we felt it was more, in a way, flows from Jmeter, in the sense that it's an older tool. It's our solution actually meant to be scriptless, and it is mostly scriptless still. So that was to make it easy to use, to make it faster. We have told to people who are we actually have converted Jmeter users to our solution,
Are you using messaging or for memory leaks inside a console for when you're orchestrating in an ESB? How are you?
What do you mean?
You have a memory leak. Most ESBs will notify you through messaging.
Yeah. So yeah, we don't collect information about memory leaks, because that is going to be part of the ESP, and then you would get notified. Like if you are doing the testing, So, like I said, we do have a way of integrating with a monitoring solution like New Relic, but there are other ways that we have customers that are using our solution, and they have systems like CloudWatch or other, you know, a monitoring system that will tell you if there are problems with memory leaks or CPU utilizations or anything, you know, that can be a problem in terms of infrastructure. But we don't collect this type of data directly, and we don't notify you for that.
So what does it typically expose? What kind of problems did it expose?
Yeah, so the type of data that we provide are what we call more like the end-to-end type of information. So the product is based on HTTP requests, so it will send requests and get information like the total response time or the throughput, if there are errors, what kind of errors, and then we got distributions, averages, error rates, and information like to this level.
And when Obamacare was initially released, what was the problem, do we know?
Well, the details I don't know, but they had a lot of problems. I don't think there was one problem. I think the main problem was that it wasn't tested, you know, and so that nobody really did a thorough testing in this area. And I know people like, for instance, a New Relic was then called in after the fact together with other company. At that time, we didn't exist, basically. So we were in the thinking, you know,
right,
when Obamacare started. So,
So I guess I'm trying to understand, does it expose lack of scalability or a configuration issue? Because there are two types of scenarios. For example, if my database is running, if it's why I asked OLTP or like, for example, a polyglot or a, you know, NoSQL type of one, the type of problems that exist are a little bit different. You could have problems with mutexes, with latches, locks in a typical OLTP scenario. So if you are running that, if you're running out of that, then probably adding more databases would help in that scenario, for example. So would it expose those type of things? Then if so, I mean, what kind of details will it give is what I'm trying to understand.
Yeah, well, we look at the terms of requests, okay? So if you do have a request for the database, the request that generates then queries to a database, or, you know, like you're writing to a database, we will see, you know, we will be able to tell you the request took longer with this database as opposed to this other one, or with this configuration as opposed to this other one. Like in the example earlier of the containers, you know, the person who started to use containers, they wanted to look at the performance. And initially they didn't see, they saw a degradation of the performance in a way. But then you realized that they started to tweak the container. Containers have a lot of configuration. So he started to tweak a CPU, memory, and so on. And then he was able to, because he really wanted to use the containers because it was a better solution, a more viable solution for him. And eventually configured the system so that it worked for his needs. So sometimes.
But it was up to him to tweak.
And then you have to
right
tweak,
way.
Exactly. You have to interact and it will be.
So,
Does one more question? Does it expose problems related to database sharding?
Well, in specific, we don't. Like I said, if there is, we don't go to the level of this level. What we are trying to do with the new solution, the machine learning, is to go to a level that tells you, okay, this area is the one that is causing you the problem. Okay, but the data that we provide, it could be sharding. I mean, sometimes that's why it's difficult, and that's most of the solutions available now. They are like this, you know, they tell you there is a problem, or it's slow, or it could be faster, but they don't tell you exactly where the problem is. And then sometimes you have to go and tweak. We had customers who had, it felt like the servers were fine, it didn't get anything, no problems, but it was pretty slow, and then it turned out it was the load balancer that wasn't configured correctly.
Right.
And so then they had to go and look at the load balancer.
So you're thinking that with machine learning, you can collect patterns?
Yes.
And then, like, make an educated guess. It's like maybe your load balancer is.
Yeah, and even that is probably, especially at the beginning, is not going to be like 100% you know, certainty. But it will tell you, okay, I saw that your when you were running the test, you know, like you had a certain amount of users. And then you know, like, and then you see the performance deteriorating. And around the same time, there were this thing that all of a sudden, instead of taking like 10 milliseconds, it took like 100 milliseconds, for instance. And there was like, there were three, four things. And then you start looking at this area, and they say maybe something is happening there that is not right.
And then you can use the user feedback to improve your
yes, and then you can improve exactly
the learning in
exactly and
yeah.
learning yeah that's and improving that
absolutely
yeah. So I'm kind of new to the API world because we just started recently to build our own API, and we started to run some basic tests with the Postman. But what my understanding is that I would like to test, for example, my API with certain patterns.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, let's say I define a pattern, a typical user pattern, and then I would like to combine those patterns in different frequency, different ways, and try to create, simulate a real,
A more real, yeah.
Load, okay.
Yes.
So you provide also tools to mix and match those kind of.
Yes, so we do have a way of creating what we call, so we have this concept that each pattern, we call it a session.
Yeah.
And so we have this concept of multi-session, so that you can create a single test where you can have your traffic distributed among different, so you have, let's say you have 1,000 users, and you could have like, I don't know, 3, 4, 5 different patterns, and each of them could have a percentage of this, like we define it right now as percentages. So we have like, I don't know, you can say 10% in here, 30 there, 70 there, and so on, so that you can get you know, your full traffic distributed. And you can distribute through geographies too. So you can say some of it has to come from the East Coast, some of it comes from Europe, some of it comes from South America or Asia. And so you can also decide, you know, and distribute your users that way. Yeah.
Well, thank you. Thank you very much.
Yeah, thank you.
Closing remarks.
Yeah, okay, closing remarks.
Thank you very much to Paola and Michele.